elixir.
Okay, folks. The July 17th meeting of the Depot Bay City Council was called to order. Please rise to the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you and welcome, everyone. Would you call the roll, please, Jeff?
Callender?
Here.
Short?
Here.
Goddard?
Here.
Gambino?
Here.
Left?
Here.
Bates?
Here.
Grant?
Aye.
We have a full house.
Not a forum. Okay. Do I hear a motion to approve the minutes of July 3rd?
Mayor, let's move to approve the minutes of the regular Depot Bay City Council meeting of July 3rd, 2018.
By Gambino, seconded by Short. Any discussion? Roll, roll, please.
Callender? Yes. Short?
Yes.
Goddard? Yes. Gambino?
Yes.
Left?
Yes.
Bates?
Yep.
And Grant?
Yes, thank you. Accounts payable?
Mayor, let me move to approve accounts payable as presented, and I can help answer any questions.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Moved by Gambino, seconded by Short. Any discussion? Roll, roll, please.
Short?
Yes.
Goddard?
Yes.
Gambino?
Yes.
Left?
Yes.
Bates?
Yep.
Grant?
Yeah.
Callender?
Yes.
Okay. First item on the agenda tonight under special orders is a brief presentation from Kurt Lent about a shuttle service. Oh, good to have. Oh, where's the sign-in sheet?
I'll go grab it.
Okay, thank you.
We had our CPR class.
Yeah, have a seat. We just need you to sign in, but we'll get the sheet. In the meantime, why don't you introduce yourself?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kurt Lent, and I am the co-founding partner with that young lady right back to Rita Carpelia. And we are starting that Carpel Motor. We're going to be a shuttle bus service that we're going to be servicing our first we're going to expand obviously our route system, but our first attempt at this is going to service from the south side of the Newport Bridge to the north end of Lincoln City. From 5 a.m. to 3 a.m., 7 days a week. I'm hoping, obviously, needless to say, that we all become fast friends. We are very receptive. We gave you our communication information. We're very receptive to hearing your ideas, inputs, your concerns, how to help us better develop a system that services the entire needs packages. As I'm sure all of you but try to manage to do the best we can. I've got extensive experience in ground transportation. I have a ground transportation, a cab and shuttle company in Spokane, Washington for quite a bit of experience as far as ground transportation stuff goes. I've already started at campaign via Facebook and Twitter. It'll be ramped up so that we go through Instagram, all those type of things. Really what I'm looking for from the city administration, others, the business owners, any suggestions on where to make our shuttles? Jeff and I were talking of some potential ideas here. There'll be a northbound side that needs to be addressed twice in Depot Bay, and then south side twice. We want to have it, we want to try to get it open down, obviously, so that people have an opportunity to get it to flow through now. As far as like rate sheets go and stuff, I can't really give you that information currently. I'm working
do as far as my ticket prices go. We'll be using the Mercedes-Benz 14-passenger shuttle buses. Initially, the first four vehicles in service won't have a wheelchair lift, but that's something I wanted to expand into. What I need to do is basically get the timing down, the north-south logistics. Being it's on the hour and we got four vehicles, the vehicle that originates in Newport has to be at the end route at the end of the hour to turn around and go back. So my vehicles are pretty much being in constant motion for the 22 times a day that it will come through northbound and or southbound. So we're looking for participation, obviously, from the business leaders in this town. We have advertising techniques that we can use. We're going to use exterior advertisements on the vehicle, and there'll be a display advertisement on the interior vehicle. That will be an audio as well. There'll be GPS. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the GPS systems, but the way they work now, based on your GPS, if I'm, say, for instance, I'm advertising a certain gas station, it won't advertise it when I'm beyond a quarter mile beyond it that way or half mile beyond it that way. I can set the perimeters that say when I want it to come into play, when I don't want it to be talked about, a real estate office, a restaurant in particular, anybody that's advertising with us, that will be oriented based on GPS device in the vehicle. It'll be a streaming audio so that people, I'd say I feel like probably 70% of my traffic is going to be residents. 30% I think would be for tourists.
Tourists aren't going to be as familiar with this. Now we've taken our platform to join as many groups as we can on Facebook and Instagram and all that type of things so that we can present to the community at large to know that we have a shuttle system here. And ultimately, our end game is Waltport to the store. So that'll be our north south, and then we'll be working on inland lines going through. So
each one of these, when I add another leg to the process, it'll just fit right inside of the framework of what I establish here between Newport and Lincoln City. So that it'll make my logistics going farther in that direction be a lot easier to deal with. So other than that, I asked any of y'all's participation. Email me at any time, contact, call us if you want at any time. If you have any questions, any concerns, any rules that you think for some reason I haven't addressed, I can always tell you. I'm not always got everything, but I certainly try. I know the state regulations as far as shuttle services go. We are different. Keep this in mind. We are different than the buses. We are a private shuttle service. We are not a public entity. So we don't fall under a lot of the rules that the city buses fall under. One of my emphasis to all of the business leaders, all of the council, all of the law enforcement, police, ambulance, all the people that need to know us, is that we aren't going to deviate from a route. We're not driving way off into a community. We can't do what the buses will do. I can't have the coverage from one end to another. I can't have that hourly coverage if I'm driving off into, like, down into the marina parking lot. It's too far to go. It'll take too much time away from the system. And then as far as like where we make our stops along the road, I would encourage you to think, if you make any suggestions of that, the driver is required to get out of a driver's door to go around. So the driver's at risk in the traffic. So I'm saying, if you make a suggestion, think about a place that a vehicle can get far enough off the road where I don't impede any traffic whatsoever, and I don't risk my drivers any safety, having to jump out in between cars or anything like that. So that's the types of things, suggestions, if you're going to make to me, that I'll be seriously taking a look at. We're in this community all day, every day. We drive through here. We have business interests here in this community. So I'm paying attention to pretty much every crack in the sidewalk, the suggestions of the places to stop. Needless to say, I
know. And the other side of the bridge to basically where the kind of the little business district ends, that's out of the question for pullover.
Kurt, I have a question. You said you don't have to follow some of the regulations that bus companies have to follow. Have you checked to make sure that as a new business you can start without offering any kind of access to handicapped people? Because we have at least three who I personally know in Depot Bay who I know would be delighted to have a service like this. I think the whole town will be delighted. It would be great. I wish you every success. But I do have a concern that you make sure it's legal for you to start without that. That's an active group, and at least one of those three will be after you. Like,
yeah, our intentions in the fact that we're a private entity and we're not publicly funded, that's one of the big switches. You know, the bus systems most of their money comes from government, some capacity, and all of the way that they operate. You know? So they're required to, for sure, have wheelchair access and that kind of stuff. Now, it's something I want, for sure. But because I'm a private shuttle, I act just like, you know, you go to the airport, they have private shuttles that run. Some of them do have wheelchair access, some of them don't. So it's, you know, it falls under, we do have a different set of rules. But I will highlight the area of rules, and I know via Jeff I can get,
yes,
I can send an email, and I will specifically send in any highlighted areas when it comes to addressing handicap needs. But I do want you all to know, it's in my first sphere. Now, I say about the vehicle, you're all pretty familiar with those big Mercedes-Benz. So they're 14 passenger vehicle. We got two seats on one side, one seat on the other, all the way down the center. If you have a wheelchair access, and say you've already sold 13 tickets, and you're filled coming here, you get in town, the putting the handicapped person in the wheelchair in there takes away four seats. So all of a sudden I have to get three people to disembark. If I had to, I would go with a bigger vehicle stop. But as my research shows me right now, I'm not limited in my demand. You know, but I'll definitely make sure all of the issues, any of this, you know, because I want to be. I had people asking specifically on Facebook. You know, as soon as I made the announcement, they were asking about stopping at senior communities. And or offering senior discounts. You know, most of them seemed like the first few questions that came right up in that. And so, you know, I want to be all inclusive. Right? But, like, necessarily, unless the senior community is right on the edge of the road where we can pull into the driveway, now it comes down to an issue of timing. Disembark a handicapped person probably in about 15 minutes. Load them in, you know. And so the city buses have a little more flexible because they don't have the demand of route time. The one thing that we do, that if I was to have, the only way I could make it have more flexibility on route time is to cut down the amount of service, run times.
Okay. I want to make sure others have a chance to ask you questions.
Okay. It took about a year, but on the Lincoln County Transit Committee to plan where the increased bus service would be for the county. One thing that they absolutely could not give Depot Bay that there seemed to be a demand for is a dial-a-ride service where both Newport and Lincoln City were able, for their seniors, to get the transit company can do dial-a-ride to take people to appointments or shopping, but they couldn't do it for Depot Bay unless the person could get down to 101. Is there any chance that you could ever provide that service? Because
yeah,
that's definitely needed, and it's not competing with the
county. I can expand into that. You know, the the ILRI, as it stands now, those types of programs are largely, mostly 90%, 95 to 100% funded by the state. One of the areas that I'm trying to stay out of is taking any public money. If I take public money, I have to offer drug and alcohol rehab, counseling, there's these layers and layers and layers and layers of bureaucracy that go with taking the public money. And I'm trying to, like Valley Retriever did, 30 years. They ran a business that stood solely on the sales of the tickets alone. They didn't take any public money, you know, so they had a really good business. And I'm really surprised that somebody hadn't picked up that mantle of what he had instantly. I'm going to. My expansion, you know, I want to take the same route across the Highway 20. It's a whole lot easier route now than what Valley Retriever had to do because they had the old route. So now we got the new road that goes around Highway 20. Makes it easier. The part of it, you know, when I come to do my inland legs, those vehicles will be a minimum of 24 passenger vehicles and they will have wheelchair access instantly. That is a vehicle that would be something we'd be addressing for sure.
John?
Hey, Kurt. So how many vehicles are you going to be running on the route?
We're right now to start with. We'll have four.
Okay. And what's your cycle time? So if we say we're going to pick up right here, right in front of the city hall. Okay. There's a room there. So how many times a day could I count on your service being coming by that spot?
22 going north. 22 going south.
22 minutes?
No, 22 times. You said how many times could I count on
being 22 times? That's a lot.
An hour.
Okay. Huh?
An hour cycle time.
So 1 hour cycle time, okay.
The vehicle that starts in Newport, ends at the casino, okay. It leaves at 5, it's at the casino by 6.
So, I'm a business person that is interested in a couple of places here along the coast, the hotels, mainly the condos down here, and I could be one of your customers for advertising, or making some arrangements here, at least here in Depot Bay, to provide shuttle service down Depot Bay on a certain cycle if we can count on that, and so they can come enjoy my brewery without having to worry about, you know, drinking and driving.
Right. That's something I'm actually specifically advertising in my startup pack.
We can get together. I'm not going to do business on the counts of time, but I think that your idea, anything that moves around people, moves people around the counties, in my opinion, it sounds good to me. It sounds great, and I wish you all the luck.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Anyone else have a question for Kurt? Thank you very much for coming. We appreciate it, and we will look forward to getting more information. If you get it to Jeff, he'll make sure it gets out to
you. Sure, council. I will, absolutely, positively. And then, you know, as again, I invite any feedback anywhere along the way. If you happen to get if you're a business owner and you happen to get a phone call from me, I'm going to be talking about advertisement and access. Just understand that this town warrants two stops. One at this end of town, one at that end of town. That way we got all the concerns like what we're talking about. I have people being able to enjoy business.
Good. Thank you very much. Okay, the next item on the agenda is a report of officers, boards, and standing committees. Salary survey committee.
Yes. I've still been meeting with Carla and Paul, and unfortunately Jerome's not able to.
Do we have a meeting tomorrow morning at 8 a.m.?
Possibly, I don't know. We'll have to talk about that later.
I'm ready.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So 2 weeks ago, when I presented a proposal from LGPI, that's the Local Government Personnel Institute, we haven't had a chance to go over have a chance to go over anything. And so we've been discussing it further. And none of this had been put into the budget, a salary survey for the year. And so I was just kind of shocked by how much it was. But when I and Carla and Paul were talking about it, we haven't done any surveys for years and years and years. And so it is. This is like a starting point. And we do have some money in our contingency fund to provide this service this year. It's just a starting point to get us started so that every year, 3 years, we wouldn't have this much of a cost. But this is a very comprehensive survey of our employees' salaries, and it's something. Breakdown of where the funding would come from the different contingencies that we have for the year. And so I'm confident now that that we can pay for it, that it would be a very huge benefit.
Hold on a second. What you told me the other day that contingency funds were only for emergencies. At our meeting yesterday?
No, it's not just for emergencies. That's the basic.
Oh, I thought that was the safety. Oh,
yeah, the safety fund is emergency services.
Okay.
I did my homework on this.
Okay. Oh, no, I'm not concerned about that. I thought you told me it was for both. Okay, that's fine.
But I think we have wonderful employees. We need to compare how we're doing with other cities. Go ahead, Joel.
Oh, it's just, if we end up having a meeting tomorrow morning,
yeah.
I'll be here. Okay. I would like to, see if we can, this is down from the first figure that I saw, okay?
Correct.
And I would like to include on the cities of similar size in state at least one or two out of state.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, that's something
there's always, in any of these cities, there's going to be differences in demographics.
Absolutely.
And, which includes cost of living.
Correct.
So, but it might be a fair comparison to not a lot, maybe a couple.
Sure. Absolutely.
Nearby states. Yeah. Washington and Idaho.
Yeah, Idaho.
You know?
She said it takes about 10 to 12 weeks to do this whole survey. So we probably won't get it until the end of summer. And they don't bill us all at once. It's billed after every month. They send a monthly bill of the hours that they spend.
She says, this is a good faith estimate, however, it is not a fixed bid.
Correct. But we do have a contract.
Okay, and then it will be a fixed bid.
Have you gotten anybody, did they do a similar study for any nearby cities?
Newport.
Oh, Newport. Oh, yeah. Yeah, we do have Newport. I'm sorry. But they really compile a lot of data for us, and it would be would be a good starting base for us to have something for our employees to know where we're at, what we're offering. In 2012, we had an employee spend the time did the survey. So we don't really have employees it was not a comprehensive.
Oh, is the committee asking for something?
We're asking for the council to approve this survey and to go forward with it and to be able to sign the contract.
Do I hear a motion?
That's all, yeah, we can find that out tomorrow.
Okay, so I'll make the motion that we started negotiating the contract and the parameters of the study, okay, for the estimate written here. That's my motion.
Second. Okay. Dollar amount so that it's on the record is $10,246, the cost of the survey. Yes?
It will go down $586 because we've already paid our membership.
Oh, okay. Wonderful. I think we should leave it at the $10,246 and maybe it will cover the other two states that you're on.
Okay.
I hear a second.
Yeah, I'm second.
Oh, you second.
We have a second.
He first did.
He first did. Okay. Moved by Grant, seconded by Gambino. Any further discussion? Call roll, please.
Short?
Yes.
Goddard?
Yes.
Gambino?
Yes.
Left?
Yes.
Bates?
Yeah.
Grant?
Aye.
Calendar?
Yes.
So moved.
Thank you.
The motion is passed. Okay. Public comments. Anyone out there have any public comments?
No. Can you go back to reports?
Oh, more reports? Oh, yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
I couldn't figure out what that meant.
Well, Brian, I'm here as the chair of the Traffic Safety Commission. People been walking down Sunset, down Alcides, and down Vista back to the highway 101. And looking at, as Sunset goes down at the foot of the hill, coming off 101, the same thing with Vista, and a sign each there, and then a sign at either end of North and South End of Alcides. I talked to Brady a little bit about it today. But we're wanting to, City Council permission to move on.
Have you talked to the neighbors?
No.
Is it in the city? We've got it right away. Yeah. And then I need to purchase about, well, to cover the areas, one more salt point, maybe two to three on four on North Point.
Four,
there's
four
none there
right
now.
Right.
There's so it's probably a total of probably six to eight more pedestrian, slow down for pedestrian. Well, spread out through town.
Spread out through town.
Oh,
yeah,
I thought
you
meant just
town.
This one.
No, I need another one on Winchell. I need one like on.
I think
I'm going to try to get the county to put a couple on. I talked to the county superintendent of the Public Works, and he's on board with it. He's seen our sign up by the parking lot there at the top of the hill at Barnhouse. So
how many?
Aren't there signs in your budget?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we have that.
Okay.
Yeah, we're just going to let the council know I'm going to purchase about probably six to eight signs for the whole town, plus some other no parking signs.
That will include Mr. Bryant's area?
Yeah. Parties. I'm going to have.
Sharker, bro. So
So we're talking sunset, are two or four, what were you thinking?
Well, we can do one at sunset and one at Vista, because you can't get a Mossy without going one of those.
Right, with one of them. Yeah. I think it's a great idea. We've got a lot of pedestrians on the street here. Mm-hmm. And so do we need a motion, an action? Is this an action item?
We need permission from the city council to move ahead with it.
Well, would you entertain a motion to do that?
Grant, seconded by Gambino.
It's the Grant Gambino. That's like a law firm.
Any further discussion?
On the same subject, slightly different signage. Ellingson Street, which is an entire block and a quarter long, used to be a one-way street. The signage, signs there on Ellingson, and the arrows that used to be painted on the street are just plain gone. From Coast, where Ellingson intersects up to Evans, could use some more signage.
Right, one way.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could get ODOT to get us another sign for the highway, and then I could get some signage for that. We have the arrow emblem. Just need to get the guys to, you know, there's new pavement and they haven't been installed since the new pavement, so.
Okay, sure. That is a different discussion. I think we need to pass the motion and then discuss that.
Okay.
Okay. So any further discussion on the motion? Roll roll, please.
Gambino?
Yes.
Goddard?
Yes.
Lapp?
Yes.
Bates?
Yep.
Grant?
Aye.
Callender?
Yes.
And Short?
Yes. Okay. Now let's get back to
I'll just move forward with updating the road.
Okay.
I got notes, so we'll update the road.
Okay. Well, great.
Oh, while we're talking about transportation, I want to thank Brady for putting the sign out here on those parking spaces, because as soon as those two spaces by the mailboxes became available, we immediately got pickup trucks with boat trailers parking there during the weekend. And what was really difficult was the Sunday, it had way over into the lake.
Right.
And it was there from early morning, both Saturday and Sunday. Those were, so the neighbors who came up here to get their mail had parked.
Right, so that's going to be mail pickup only. I put a temp sign there so the guys can get it in. We're waiting for more parts, but it's going to be mail pickup only, tow away zone. So
that's great. That's really helpful.
No parking on the curvature.
Well, as soon as those trailer sailors saw those spaces, they thought, we got them. Yeah.
That's not true.
Okay, good. Okay, are there any more reports? I don't want to miss anyone else. Did you have something?
No, I'm here for the good stuff.
Oh, okay. We are now up to public comments. Does anyone have any public comments from out there? No public comments. Okay, then let's move on to unfinished business and the harbor. Come up and have a seat.
Well, I didn't come up here to make a presentation.
Oh, you're just here in case we need your wisdom. Okay.
No, okay.
Go ahead, Brady.
I was hoping to contribute something at some point. Trying to help with the solution.
Okay.
So we reached out to Ferguson Construction. They're one of the bigger players in piling and dock refurbishing through I had talked to them. They've been a recent bidder, and when we did Dock One, and they didn't receive the bid. They were a little bit high, but since then I've been talking to the owner. He came down and looked at our situation, and recommended, you know, piling replacement, obviously, and float replacement. Set our gangways look fine, our pedestals are fine. He was a bid, did some research, spent a day here in Depot Bay, came back with a bid, and that's the bid that we currently have in the numbers. And you'll see that there's just a piling replacement cost, and then a full dock floats 2, 3, and 4, and piling. And the engineer's estimate when we had the docks and pilings research back in 2015. That number was, I can't remember, it was over $4 million for plots, just at the low end of the quote price from the engineer's estimate. And that was Ferguson coming back with, less than half that, a dollar amount. It gives us a dollar figure. What this does is gives us a dollar figure that shows that there is a window. We can move forward with researching our options for getting the funding and using that as a really good piece of
they are both feeling the urgency of this work because they think they get the pressure from the fishermen who really understand what's going on and need the help. And there are options for looking for money. Okay. You know, there's the option of asking, going to the voters for a levy, which is expensive and time consuming, but is certainly a possibility. There is the option of changing the ordinance and using the money that's in the safety ordinance now that we keep picking away at for smaller projects. There's the option of trying to work out some kind of long-term payment arrangement based on, and I don't even know what other options there are, but Brady and Jeff would like to look at all of these options in more detail and then come back to council and maybe get some help from the Harbor Commission as to what's realistic and how fast we have to do what on which dock, that sort of thing. But so that we continue the forward movement. And so, and that's why this is so important. In order for them to move ahead, they've got to get approval from the full council. Just with research. They're doing research. This is just to do research.
Well, by all means, research away.
We don't really need a motion for that.
This is going to be intense and take a lot of time and effort on their part. And I think that a motion is in order because it may impact some of their other projects. Yeah.
I'd like to make a motion that Brady and Jeff have the resources made available to them to do the research for the harbor investigation.
Okay. Moved by calendar, seconded by short discussion.
Yeah, there's a little. That's true. So let's include all funding sources that we have available. I'm looking at the money that's already been set aside in the harbor.
And
the
so that's now in the harbor fund.
Okay. Because, and so let's look and see what that
we've
is.
We've got 120,000.
Right. That's a good start. So let's find out, a phased approach is probably what I think would be prudent.
And/or removal right now.
They are working on it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I lost track of where we are. We're ready to vote. We're ready to vote. Any further question? Discussion? Okay. Call the question.
We'll get left.
Yes.
Bates?
Yep.
Callender?
Yes.
Short?
Yes.
Daughter?
Okay.
Business.
I don't want to go by Lars. You said you hope to save words.
I didn't say that. I said I was just here for the good stuff. I was interested very much as being a Harbor Committee chair as to what you were going to be talking about as far as dredging and fire.
Okay.
So I'm trying to keep informed.
Gotcha.
So I haven't heard anything about dredging.
No,
that's under the same. We have nothing to report at this time.
Yeah, there is nothing to report at this point, I don't think. We're in touch back east with the powers that be. I mean, you don't have anything new, do you?
Nothing new.
No.
How many buckets do we have?
Yeah. Actually, maybe you can tell us. I know the Harbor Commission was going to move ahead with its bucket project. What happened? How can we support that?
Well, Kathy Wyatt and I were on, decided to be on a committee. She said she would like to spearhead that, and the next morning she subject that if there hasn't been one, there should be a contingency plan of how to fuel boats when they're, because I don't see any money coming down. That up to the harbor master and the city administrator, I guess, and put in our two bits too. So.
If the Harbor Commission has any recommendations about that, we would like to hear them.
We didn't really discuss it. What I see in the harbor, the rest of the harbor isn't going to ground. I mean, it's not filling up as fast, but we do have an issue with, you guys are all aware of the issue, a very shallow, a lot of mud over there by the fuel dock and dock four. We're renting out spaces to people when they come down to their boat. They can't go anywhere because their boat's sitting in the mud. On top of the mud.
That's not a good thing.
No, and maybe we have to do something about that.
Well, we've looked into the dredge that the state owns, and chances are it won't fit here, but it's also going to be $500,000.
Right, but I was talking about another issue.
Oh.
The issue of renting spaces.
Oh.
Where the boats can't always get out. Maybe we can't rent those spaces right now.
Yeah, he leaves. Right now, we haven't been. We've rented a few out, but we let the folks know that it's, they usually have a flat bottom aluminum boat or something that gets those spots.
So you're paying attention to that issue.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, should know it. Oh, absolutely.
A question for Lars. Lars, I don't know a lot about that, obviously. So when we think about dredging, especially the fact that the fuel dock, whatever number that is, has all the mud buildup, is it not true that that's because, predominantly right now, because the check dam is full?
Well, I'm not an engineer, but over my living here for my whole lifetime, I've seen that fill up incredibly fast because the check dam is full. And also, we've had probably just about unprecedented logging. If you go out in the ocean, you will see, if you look back at the hills, I'm not sure who owns this, but it seems as though they're logging everything that they can. And for, I've heard reasons is because the rules might change, and so they're wanting to get that timber out of there now. I don't know, but I see a lot of sediments coming down. The down into the bay because that check dam is full. And when we had talked to the Corps of Engineers one time, said, well, how come you guys aren't going to go dredge the check dam behind there? Because it's cost us less money. It costs 10% of the price if that mud is down in the bay and they're able to pump it out into the ocean, which they usually do, versus if they dredge it out behind it, since it's fresh water out there, the rules are different, and they have to truck it away,
right,
or something.
Right.
So the rules are different once they get on the other side of that dam, and that's all probably depending on who you talk to. But that was their explanation. So they said, we don't care if that check dam's full; just let the mud go down into the bay, and they knew it would, and they'll just pump dredge it out down there. It's way cheaper to do it.
In 5 years.
But the problem with that is that it's not being done.
Yeah.
And they say, oh, we have no money.
Hmm.
Yeah. Okay.
You can see the evidence, too, of the sediment that's in the water. When we get a respectable rain, the plume goes offshore for a long way.
Yeah.
There's a lot of it that slows down enough when it hits the area there at Dock 4 that it falls out of suspension, and there it is.
Yeah. We are also seeing erosion around that check dam. It's brought to my attention that a lot of the rock and stuff that has been around the check dam on the north and south sides isn't there anymore. And washed around, it didn't go over the dam, so the odds are it's washed back in towards the harbor.
That's one issue, too, is the Corps met with me, and they actually want the city to hire a contractor to go down at low tide and replace some of those boulders. But we have to maintain the city.
I've never really found any yet, because I was trying to figure out who was responsible for the seawall and the jetty rock. And I dug through the basement and just kind of going off what the Corps is telling me. So I was told, yes, that we have to do this emergency plan for their wall on the city's dime.
With council's permission, I would like to suggest that we instruct Brady that he talk to the engineer, Corps of Engineers, Corps about that, and just ask them for a copy of the documents.
Sure.
Yes, Jerome?
Oh, just a comment. Just I don't expect.
Okay, yes. Lauren.
I was glad to hear you mention that getting copies of the documents, because I feel that we should in turn forward those documents to our congressional delegates, so that they are aware that perhaps the Corps is trying to pass the buck.
Right. Well, let's see if we get any documents.
Yes.
That would be the first thing. So that's a really important task we've given you, Brady.
Sure.
Okay.
So if there isn't any documents, I guess I'm talking out of turn. If there isn't any documents, you don't have to do anything. You don't have to fix it.
Well, if there aren't any documents, we're in a much stronger negotiating position. That's
yes.
For sure.
But then we also have to live with it.
Yeah, I mean, you have to balance. Okay. We will report back as soon as Brady gets information or no information.
I've got a contact. The gentleman that comes down here is the one that gives me the marching orders to remove the brush from the wall and replace the boulders. I'm just going to, you know, I asked why, and he pretty much just said, well, it's because.
Well, tell him that council has specifically requested a copy of the documents,
right,
whatever contracts, agreements, or in existence between them and us. Okay, yes. Lauren.
Additionally, if there are no documents that authorize that, the first thing that comes to my mind is the permitting process for the city to be issued a permit by the Corps to do that work. How's that going to happen? Number two, if by so doing any work like that, what sort of liability does the city incur to the Corps?
One step at a time. Let's see if there are documents, and then we'll move on from there. But you're right, that's all part of the research process. That's interesting.